Is reality an illusion? Is it possible that we live in a matrix-like world with multiple layers constructed by our descendants? Ever since the movie Matrix came out in 1999, in which humans are trapped inside a virtual reality, there has been intense public speculation and debate about the nature of reality. The debate has spurred from science fiction into scientific research and has triggered the most recent surge of interest in a phenomenon called simulated reality. This phenomenon derives from the simulation hypothesis proposed by Nick Bostrom in 2003. The basic idea is that all the current existence that humans know, including the Earth and the rest of the universe, could in fact be an artificial simulation, such as a computer simulation. The simulation relies on the advancement of computer and video game technology to make the argument that humans could be living inside a computer program. What could a simulated reality look like? And how would we know if we are in one? Or what if there were multiple layers to our existence and the world we experience is just one layer? Where does consciousness and free will come into play?
Most of us intuitively imagine, when we think that we have free will, we imagine that we are the ultimate autonomous authors of our actions. We can think about the world, we can be affected by the world, but ultimately when we act, that action is originating within us. We are not mathematical beings whose strings are pulled by physical law. And that just is incoherent. We are collections of particles fully governed by physical law, and every thought that we have, every action that we take, is nothing but those particles playing out the dictates of the mathematical equations, the physical laws. So that version of free will, and I think it's the intuitive one, seems to me to be completely incoherent. Now, what happens when philosophers and scientists think about these ideas, you can go in a variety of directions with that sort of realization. And the direction that I go is a long-standing and well-respected approach called compatibilism, which is basically finding a new kind of freedom that is as valuable as the old version that isn't true, and in that way plays the role of a substitute for the thing that we lost when we recognize that that traditional free will is gone. My view, it's not a view that others haven't articulated in one form or another, is simply that what makes us special is not that we can transcend physical and mathematical law, we can't, but rather because we are so ordered and so well choreographed, we can execute a spectacular range of behaviors that are unavailable to most objects in the world. I mean, right here, even sitting here right now, I just articulated a thought through a sentence. And I take a step back and I'm like, yeah, my particles just did a reasonably good job of saying what my other particles were trying to articulate. And I sit back and I'm like, thank you, particles, for doing that. Or thank you, physical law, for allowing my particles to do that. And in that way, I actually feel a degree of gratification for the fact that my particles did something that I'm happy with. And when my particles do things that I'm not happy with, I similarly feel a degree of remorse. But that's what's going on. And all of it comes from physical law.
One of the main arguments in favor of a simulated reality is based on the exponential growth of technology. The pace of advancements in the technology industry is so fast now that every new batch of games, graphics, and consoles seems to blow the previous generation out of the water. We are now able to simulate environments in computer games that are so complex and detailed that it's hard to tell the difference between reality or a simulation. According to Brian Greene, with this kind of pace of progression, it is easy to imagine that one day we could be able to create more complex simulations.
So I think of the simulation hypothesis is perhaps the most radical of all. The possibility that we're in some futuristic supercomputer run by some kid in a futuristic garage, and all that's happening here is we are playing out the programming that that kid in the garage has set in motion. Do I consider that a likely scenario? I don't. And that kid is governed by the laws of physics at that higher level of reality. And that would be a version that would be completely compatible with accounts of the world that imagine that there's some intelligence that guides the cosmological unfolding. Nick Bostrom at Oxford makes a very interesting argument along the lines of the Boltzmann brain argument that I gave before, which is, it is very difficult to create a real universe. It's hard to spark a new Big Bang, but it might in the far future, it may be very easy to create simulated worlds. You know, just fire them up one after another after another. So if I ask you, are we in the real universe that came from the real Big Bang, or are we in the simulated universe where there was a simulated Big Bang? Again, if you're willing to just go with the odds, there are many more simulated worlds compared to real ones, and therefore if you throw a dart, you're more likely to hit a simulated world than a real one, and therefore perhaps it's more likely that we are right now in a simulated world. Again, do I buy that? Not in a deep way, but I find it a very interesting argument to think about.
According to supporters of the simulation hypothesis, our universe's strict laws of physics is evidence that we live in a simulation. Why does our universe have rules in the first place? The computer's processing power leaves an imprint of its existence within the world of the simulation it is running. If we live in a simulation, then our universe should also have such an imprint, and there should be some way to find this imprint. One idea is that the speed of light in a vacuum might be such an imprint. Another imprint in our universe, according to simulation believers, is the Planck length, the smallest possible unit in the universe. If our world is simulated, the Planck length would be equivalent to a pixel. Some people don't like the idea of the simulated world because it assumes that we are just a bunch of programmable beings without free will. According to Brian Greene, free will is an illusion, whether the simulated reality hypothesis is true or not.
Well, often people say, in a classical world, it's fully determined, and clearly there's no such thing as free will, right? You tell me the positions of the particles now, you tell me their velocities, and you just turn the Newtonian crank, and that will fully determine what happens in the future. Clearly, no room for a volitional being to intercede in that progression. Then people come along and say, but with quantum mechanics, all of a sudden there's a window opening, because now it's not fully determined. Only the probabilities of one or another outcome are determined, and they try to slip free will in there. But let's think about it. If you have an indeterministic, probabilistic set of laws, then you have random outcomes governed by the measures of quantum probabilities. Is a random outcome somehow a place where you're gonna put human freedom? I don't think so. When we have an intuition about free will, we're not imagining someone's flipping a coin back there and that's how our actions are being determined. And if that's what's going on, I don't feel any better than I do in the classical description of the world. So deterministic and indeterministic is a complete red herring. It is irrelevant to the conversation. What matters is the progression of the world governed by laws? Is there a lawful progression regardless of what those laws are? And if the answer to that question is yes, then the kind of free will that I was talking about at the outset does not exist. And so it doesn't matter the system. We are that AI system that we happen to be flesh and blood. Who cares? We're exactly the same situation. And if I could look internally and fully understand the workings of my brain, my code, it wouldn't change the conversation one single bit.
A common criticism of the simulation argument is that it assumes there is another level of reality where someone or something controls what we believe are the laws of nature, or even interferes with those laws. But if we are in a simulation, then what is to say that the programmer wouldn't have already programmed that there is no way to tell it's a simulation? Many scientists argue the existence of simulated reality, and they view it to be unprovable in any concrete sense, as there is an infinite regress problem with the argument. Any evidence that is directly observed could be another simulation itself. Even if we are a simulated reality, there is no way to be sure the beings running the simulation are not themselves a simulation, and the operators of that simulation are not a simulation. The question of our reality being a simulation is a very interesting one and has some real implications about how we should view our world and the meaning of life. Nevertheless, one should keep in mind that simulation hypothesis remains quite controversial. Experiments that could distinguish physical reality from a simulation are what would be needed for it to be a credible scientific assertion. Thanks for watching. Did you like this video? Then show your support by subscribing and ringing the bell to never miss videos like this.
Thank you.